also to congratulate Professor Kotza for the organization of the second meeting, and of course, Dr. Karas. I'm sure that this meeting will be also as successful as it was the first one last year. I would like to ask Professor Kasi to take the floor. Professor Kasi is Associate Professor of Biological Chemistry, and not biochemistry, yes. of the University of Athens to talk about molecular genetics and vitamin D action.
First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee for this honorable invitation, especially my colleague and old friend, Professor Kotza. And let's start. The title of my talk is Molecular Genetics and vitamin D action. I think that all the participants of this workshop are quite familiar with the content of this slide, which actually summarizes the vitamin D production and metabolism, as well as some of the novel extraskeletal actions of vitamin D, targeting in immune system, adipose tissue, muscle tissue, lipid profile, as well as vasculature. Very briefly, vitamin D comes in two forms, vitamin D3 and vitamin D2, which differ in their side chain. However, their biological activities of their active metabolites are quite comparable. Vitamin D3 is mainly synthesized in the skin, but is also abundant in foods of animal origin, like oil-rich fishes or cod liver oils, while vitamin D is naturally found in foods of plant origin, like mushrooms. Both D2 and D3 are inactive and need two hydroxylations to become active, calcitriol. The first hydroxylation takes part in liver and is catalyzed by this enzyme, CYP2R1, which is actually a 25-hydroxylase, and gives rise to the 25-hydroxide, which is the main indicator of the vitamin D status in the human body. Interestingly, CYP2R1 knockout mice still can produce significant amounts of vitamin D, implying that other hydroxylases may be involved in this procedure. The second hydroxylation occurs in kidney, in the proximal tubular cells of the kidney, and is catalyzed by the CYP27B1. It's actually a 1A hydroxylase and gives rise to the active metabolite calcitriol. Both, interestingly, mutations in this gene results in the vitamin D resistant rickets type 1. Both 25-hydroxide and calcitriol are degraded by this enzyme, CYP24A1, and it is interesting that ablation of this gene in mice led them to die earlier because of calcitriol toxicity. The vitamin D hormone elicits its pleiotropic effects through either classical ligand-dependent signaling and downstream modulation of gene expression, or via non-canonical genomic independent mechanisms. We are going to discuss both of them in detail later. In any case, the main mediator of the vitamin D action is the vitamin D receptor, which belongs to the nuclear receptor superfamily. Here you can see other members of this family, actually sex steroid hormone receptors, adrenal steroid hormone receptors, as well as thyroid hormone receptors. Vitamin D was discovered in 1969 as a protein activated by the calcitriol. Vitamin D receptor is present in almost all the cells of the human body, and maybe this indicates the wide range, the wide spectrum of its metabolic actions. As you can see, all members of the nuclear receptor superfamily share the same domain types. These domains are actually the amino terminal domain, which is responsive for the transactivation independent of the hormone binding, the DNA binding domain, which is responsible for the nuclear translocation of the vitamin D receptor in the nucleus and bind to specific elements. It also contains, as you can see, some areas, some regions that are responsible for the nuclear localization. The hinge region and the hormone binding domain, which is responsible for the binding of the hormone, and also contains some regions responsible for the dimerization, and the carboxyterminal domain. VDR gene, which encodes for the VDR protein, is located in chromosome 12 and consists of 14 exons, actually six of them being variants of the exon 1 and important for the alternative splicing of the vitamin D protein. The rest, 2 to 9 exons, are present in VDR coding regions and are common to all the 14 transcripts. But although we have 14 transcripts, only 3 isoforms of vitamin D are known in human body. And these are the VDRA, which is the common form of the receptor. It consists of 427 amino acids and contains exons 2 to 9. The second form is the VDRB1 receptor, which is elongated on the amino terminal locus. Actually, it contains the exons 1D and 1C. And it seems that this elongation enables a different reaction to ligands in the diverse type of tissues, suggesting that VDRA and VDRB1 activation is ligand and tissue specific. This form, we can find this form especially in intestinal and kidney cells of the human. And the third form is this one, a truncated VDRA, which is shorter, 3 amino acids shorter, is a result of a FOC1 polymorphism that is present in the start codon. And although this is a shorter form, its transcription activation has a greater transcription activation ability compared to the full-length protein. Indeed, in plasmablastic lymphoma and myeloma cells that has this variant, these cells displayed greater growth inhibition as a response to calcitriol, as well as more active immune system. But on the other side, recent meta-analysis found an association between this variant, a positive association, with the susceptibility to prostate cancer in Caucasian population. So we can say that the FOC1 presence can be a double-edged sword in relation to cancer. The different effects of the vitamin D actions in the various tissues cannot be explained just by the polymorphism of the VDR, splice variants, or tissue-specific environment. So post-transcriptional and post-translational modifications can also be an answer to this variable activity of the VDR. Let's see these processes in more detail. Regarding post-transcriptional regulation, the main way to be exerted is the microRNAs. What are microRNAs? Are a class of short non-coding RNA, about 22 amino acids, which can cause either RNA degradation, messenger RNA degradation, or a repression of translation. And this happens via recognizing specific elements. You can see these elements here. and binds to them to the three intracellular region of the messenger RNA. The first investigated microRNA regulating VDR is this one, the miR-125B, which is produced by two precursors that encoded by two genes that located in two different chromosomes. Interesting, deletions of these areas, of these regions of the chromosome, or adjacent regions, has been found in various cancers like breast, lung, ovarian, esophagus, and stomach. An inverse relationship between this miR-125, as well as the other microRNA, the 27B, an inverse relationship between this expression and VDR protein has been found. Indeed, overexpression of this miR leads to a downregulation of the VDR protein, and this we think that have a relationship with the occurrence of cancers. This, the same microRNA also inversely regulate the CYP24 protein and its activity, leading to a decreased metabolic degradation of calcitriol in cases of increased levels of this miR. So we can say that this is a possible therapeutic target, since suppressing these microRNAs, we could enhance the antitumor activity of calcitriol in various tumors. Regarding post-translational regulation of the VDR, all these processes, phosphorylation, ubiquitination, samoylation, and acetylation, can exert this regulation. Few words. The most well-studied process is the phosphorylation. We can see this serine in the position 51. It was discovered that serine at this position is a substrate for protein kinase C beta. But experiments in which researchers substitute this serine by other amino acids, and in regard which, irrespective of their ability to be phosphorylized or not, they found that the secondary structure of this region around the serine 51 appears to be more important for the calcitriol-induced transcriptional activity. The phosphorylation at these sites leads to a decreased VDR transcriptional activity, and also serine at this position is a target of protein kinase A and leads again to a decreased transactivation by calcitriol. It is important to note that both kinases, protein kinase C as well as protein kinase A, are found increased in several cancers, and in some cases they are related, causally related to these cancers. In contrast, phosphorylation at this position at serine 208 leads to an increased transactivation via enhancing the protein-protein interaction between VDR and co-regulatory proteins. More, both these sites, 208 and 272, are targeting by this kinase. This is the ATM, Ataxia telangiectasia mutant kinase, which is clearly related to cancer. Actually, it's a kinase that is a DNA damage responder. And it is important to note that calcitriol induces this kinase, leading to a positive feedback loop between oncogene stress and cancer prevention by vitamin D. This is the complete list of kinases up to date that can regulate the transcriptional activity of VDR, but there are indications that other kinases can regulate this activity, actually GNK, either alone or in cooperation with P38, can positively regulate the VDR expression, resulting in an increased calcitriol-mediated inhibition of the cancer cell proliferation, other colon or breast cancer. Ubiquitination is another process which is important because induces the degradation of a short-lived proteins in eukaryotic cells by the proteasome pathway. It has been found that in contrast with other members of the nuclear receptor superfamily, the VDR is protected by degradation in the presence of calcitriol. And it seems that important role to this process plays this site, the lysine, at the position 399. Acetylation, there is no proof clear clear proof for VDR protein acetylation. Samoylation, an essential mechanism for the genome stability. Sorry. Samoylation of the VDR serves as a potent inhibitor of transcriptional response to calcitriol. And it seems that lysine at this position, 91, has been identified as an acceptor site for the samoylation. All these processes are implicated in the regulation of the genome actions of VDR via either controlling the amount of receptor or modulating its transcriptional activity by other ways or both. But how exactly these genomic actions, the VDR mediated, can occur, can exert it? I think that we are familiar with this figure. Actually, calcitriol enters the cell, binds to the VDR, and then the activated VDR heterodimerizes with RXR, and this complex goes to the VDREs. What we know for these VDREs, actually, VDREs composed of two directly repeated consensus hexanucleated half sites separated by three and in some cases by six base pairs that are generally located within kilobase or so of the promoters of these genes. But the VDRE sequence can vary and this can affect the ability of the receptor. The location of the VDRE upstream or downstream of the promoter or on the promoter, as well as the number of sites can influence the transcription. And finally, whether VDR is liganded or not may also influence these interactions and the recruitment of co-regulatory activators or suppressors. Let's see what happened after the formation of this complex. These interact with a primary coactivator such as this one, the steroid receptor coactivator 2, and which has histone acetylase activity, and this can recruit other secondary activators such as CBP300, which has also histone acetylase activity. But this complex also interacts with this mediator complex, which can facilitate the activation of the RNA polymerase holoenzyme. Finally, this complex, SUI-SNF, which remodels chromatin, can also help the activity of the activated VDR of this complex. Here you can see the principles of the calcitriol-mediated gene regulation in target cells. All these, I want to stay to the first and the last one. We know that we have VDR binding sites that are about 1,000 in the absence of calcitriol, and this number increases to 2,000 to 8,000 in the presence of calcitriol. And important is that the VDR binding sites are highly dynamic and they change during cell differentiation, maturation, and disease activation, and thus have consequent effects on gene transcriptions. Okay, but vitamin D can regulate the transcription of genes that do not contain VDREs in their promoter. This action can happen and involves protein-protein interactions and may explain some of the modulatory effects of the calcitriol that exerted in the innate and adaptive immunity, antiviral responses of the cells, and cell survival. Such targets include NF-kappa-B pathway, Such targets include NF-kappa-B pathway, signal transducers and activators of transcription, STAT1, RANK, CJUN, beta-catenin, as well as CREB. Let's see some examples. In case of NF-kappa-B, we have to note that this transcription factor plays critical roles in inflammation and immunity, and dysregulation of these pathways is associated with inflammatory and autoimmune diseases and cancer. As you can see in this figure, the activated VDR can interact with IKB, so prevent it to go to degradation, to be phosphorylated and then go to degradation. So this complex of P65 and P50 cannot go inside the nucleus and find the NF-kappa-B response elements in order to regulate the transcription of the response genes. In case of IL-2, which is known that is negatively regulated by the vitamin D, you can see that herein the complex RXR and VDR can interact. We don't know how exactly, but can interact with NFAT and prevent the formation of this complex in order to start the transcription of IL-2. Moreover, they can induce the sequestration of the RAX1, so in another way prevent the transcription of IL-2, and the same for IL-17. And finally, we would like to say a few things about the new receptor, a membrane VDR. We know now that some actions, they can mediate it via VDR membrane, non-genomic. You can see here that vitamin D can bind to a membrane VDR, which is located here in the cell surface, or it has been visualized in a perinuclear area. This binds vitamin D and activates signaling molecules such as protein kinase C, PI3 kinase, phospholipase C, and the MAP kinase pathway, but can also crosstalk with the genomic effects. This membrane VDR is also the same with these names, GRP58, ERP57, or PDA3. And here you can see the interaction between the membrane VDR and the nuclear VDR, both synergistically, in many cases, can act inside and regulate signaling molecules that finally can result in genomic effects. To sum up, calcitriol mode of action has deviated from one that is relied on just the nuclear VDR to effect its genomic function to the acceptance of membrane VDR and the role of non-genomic actions. These non-genomic actions regulate a wide range of calcitriol-mediated genomic and cellular functions that impact on general physiological processes, including bone remodeling, cellular proliferation and differentiation, immune regulation, and anti-cancer and antiviral bacterial activities. And a better understanding of the genomic and non-genomic actions of calcitriol may provide avenues to modulate further its actions. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Cassi, for keeping the time equally and for this very interesting introduction to vitamin D receptor actions.
I make an effort to do this.
Any questions? May I ask one? The truncated analogs of vitamin D, do they exert the exact role, the exact action as the non-truncated ones, or as it happens to other members of the nuclear receptor superfamily? They are dotted with specific actions, sometimes antagonizing the normal ones.
In case of the one variant, the FOC1 variant, which is known to be truncated by three amino acids, they thought that this had an increased activity, transcriptional activity, and I don't know if... I answer to this question. You mean the truncated, not analogs, the truncated receptors. I think that in case of this one, we don't know yet if they exert increased or decreased transcriptional activity. So the presence of these truncated forms may increase or decrease the transcriptional activity. As well as many of the polymorphisms, because I present only this one, there are plenty of polymorphisms of the VDR that are related either positively or negatively to various diseases, a long list of diseases, which is bigger and bigger, is longer and longer. So the presence of these truncated forms may increase or antagonize the function of the full-length VDR.
Yes, Dr. Grant. Dr.
We discuss about different vitamin D concentrations that may be effective to prevent different diseases. Is it possible that the receptor may have a different affinity depending on the cell that it is located, or is it that different receptors may mediate this effect?
Both.
Okay.
Both of them.
Yeah.
And I would like to say that the wide genome association studies have shown that that there is a genetic influence on vitamin D levels by 24-25 hydroxylation, as well as DBD, the binding protein that actually transports the vitamin D and all the metabolites of the vitamin D all over the body. There is
so it's a local metabolism of vitamin
exactly,
D that may also...
We know that vitamin D receptor, as well as 1-hydroxylase, are present in almost all the cells of the body. So this means that vitamin D can exert effects on the whole body. There is a wide spectrum of biological effects, and that there is a local production of the vitamin D and a fine-tuning for the local intercellular levels.
Okay, thank you.
So, Professor Cassi, thank you for your excellent and superb lecture. Regarding this fine-tuning, what is your opinion about the regulatory effects of megalincubilin? And the second question regarding the immunoregulatory actions on cathelicidin, on calcitriol. There are two aspects that are highly engaged in the current literature.
Yes, actually, I focused my... What? Actually, I focused regarding my talk. I focused on general mechanisms of action, so I didn't talk about specific regulatory functions, and I didn't conclude. I haven't concluded this information in my talk. Please, can you repeat your question? What is my opinion regarding?
Megalink coupling is an alternative mechanism of 25-hydroxy to get into the renal cell, at least.
Yes, this is a mechanism in order the 25-hydroxy, yes. Along with the DBD, to get inside the cells and then exert their, in one case, become activated
by the one
hydroxylase. This is a very fine tuning that can exert it differently in the various cells. And it is important in the intestinal cells, kidney cells, but elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I absolutely agree. Because we are linking 25-hydroxy status with the beneficial effects of supplementation. And this doesn't have to do always with local calcitriol production. This has to be implicated in clinical practice, since attaining adequate status means that you have beneficial effects not only through local calcitriol production, but also through megalink coupling, which enters at least renal cells or placenta.
Yes, because this this mechanism facilitates the entrance of the of the vitamin D.
Regarding cathelicidin,
this is important for the antivirus and antimicrobial effects of the vitamin D.
Thank you so much. Any other questions? So thank you very much, Professor Cassie.